There you are. I'm just off to Melbourne for tonight's show, the first in the series of shows I'm making here in Australia, and I'm really so excited about it. Tonight we've got the thrilling June Bronhill, we have the internationally renowned ventriloquist Chris Kirby, the delectable Brenda Kristen, the first ever appearance, Australian appearance that is, of the American pop group The Grotesques. We shall be meeting the world's fastest bingo caller, who works in a nudist colony. Eyes down, look in and try not to laugh. And lots of other surprises. Why don't you sit back now, relax, and enjoy Jeff Richards' first edition. See you in a minute.
Extra, extra, I'm in love. I've got to thank my lucky stars above.
Hooray.
Celebrate, it's our fact. We got a first rate act, it's evident. When we make love, the day of the best. You're my every thought. You're my one attraction. You must be heaven.
Thank you very much. That's very nice. Thank you very much there, Jeff Richards, first edition, by the way. And may I say, first of all, to all of you, how thrilled I am to be, you know, in Australia for my first variety special. You know, it's really lovely. Being recorded here in sunny Melbourne. It is lovely. No, it is sunny, isn't it? Isn't it sunny?
Yes.
Yes. They'll say anything for a funny hat and a picture of Bert Newton. I must say that Channel 9, you know, have been very kind to me. They've been very, I mean, since I arrived, they've gone out of the way to make me happy. Twice a week, a lady from Meals on Wheels comes round. Squirts Vegemite through my letterbox. They've also asked me to be a regular guest here on World of Sport, taking part in all those strenuous events, you know, with Australia's greatest sportsman. Unfortunately, I had to retire rather early in the weightlifting contest. I gave myself a hernia putting my leather belt on. I didn't do too well in the field events either. I was disqualified for running underneath the hurdles. No, I actually take my exercise very seriously. I mean, only the other morning I was out doing press-ups in Fitzroy Gardens. The magistrate wouldn't believe me, and I got fined $25. Now, I was telling you about how... you are lovely. I was telling you about how marvellous Channel 9 have been. You know, I mean, they give me this marvellous dressing room back there. I mean, it's got a bedroom, two bathrooms, very luxurious. They built it from Graham Kennedy. And Don Lane has the lease now. And I'm in there, you know, my dressing in Don Lane's hip pocket. Don't laugh, it's a fabulous view from up there. Actually, talking about views, I must tell you how beautiful the views are around about here. I mean, my wife and I, she's down here with me, drove along the Mornington Peninsula to Portsea last weekend, and it really is beautiful. I mean, it's not the first time I've been down there. I spent a couple of weeks in Australia staying at Portsea with relatives, you know, when I was small. Last week, as a matter of fact. We even visited the charming little Victorian guest house we used to stay in down there. It was run by a spinster lady, Miss Pentecost, and she had very hard and fast rules regarding the hotel. You know, you had to be in bed by 10 o'clock. You know, she was adamant about that, 10 o'clock. She didn't like to be kept waiting. And I still go back. I can still remember when I was very young, my mum and dad took me there. We used to go down to the beach, and there was that air of dignity, you know, and grace on the beach. They were all real pommies, you know, and I was watching, you know, as the boots and the socks came off and the braces dangled and the top hat remained on and in for a paddle, you know. I used to think to myself, I wish you wouldn't do that, mother. We used to stay with Miss Pentecost because it was, you know, it was absolutely spotless. She had this thing about hygiene, about clean food, you know. I mean, she took hygiene in the kitchen to ridiculous lengths, to extreme, really. Gave herself a lot of extra work. I mean, she used to be up 4:30 every morning washing the cornflakes. I don't know if you ever tasted sausages after they spent half an hour in the spin dryer. It's not very... Like, Portsea itself must be one of the cleanest resorts in Australia, spotless. You know, they even have a very tall policeman diverting seagulls to Rosebud. But to get back to Miss Pentecost, she was very, very prim lady, the landlady, prim Victorian, you know. She had her hair in a bun and her nose in a crab sandwich. As I said, I visited the hotel for old time's sake, and she still has this, to this day, has this lovely trio playing light music in the lounge, you know, absolute suggestion of bygone days. And she said, would you ask the trio to play me something from the Chocolate Soldier, she said. I said, certainly, which part of the Chocolate Soldier would you like? She said, the bit with the nuts in. Now that's... However, on to tonight's show. First of all, the bad news, we are unfortunately unable to bring you the famous novelty act, Ron Squibb, the Human Torch, as he's gone out for the evening. But we do have a great show lined up for you, and maybe we'll be back right away with Brenda Kristen after these messages. Thank you very much. Just a reminder before we go on that this is not the Muppet Show. Now, I have to make that clear because, you know, after the last shows, a lot of people wrote in saying, why is it we never see his legs? Well, they are there, I assure you. If you look very close, they're there. Oh, by the way, if there's anyone from the Festival of Light watching this evening, I can assure you there will be no sex or swearing or nasty, brutal violence on this program. That all starts when the show finishes and we all pile into the pub next door. Right. But while we're still in one piece, let's give a very big welcome to a lovely lady with a beautiful song. It's Brenda Kristen with the theme from Beretta, Keep Your Eye on the Sparrow. Ladies and gentlemen, Brenda Kristen.
Oh, it's a world full of trouble that we are in now. Can't take any more than the legal laws allow. The judges will jail you, preachers will shout, bad talk will nail you. When the truth gets out, society will frown. It's a world full of trouble.
Really lovely. I really enjoyed that. Very nice. Very nice. Because actually, I haven't seen you now since Singapore, when you were working in that rather
swish
hotel.
It was.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it was very well run, I might have.
Beautifully run, yes. So I heard.
Well, a waiter got the sack a week before for having his thumb in the soup.
Goodness me.
Yes.
As I heard that. And a topless waitress for two similar offences.
You were working that tiny little club downtown, the St. John's Women's Institute of Go-Go.
That's right, yes. That's right, you remember that. I'll never forget the night you came in. I can remember, I was sitting in the corner, sipping my third Bonox of the evening, and... and the orchestra struck up on his mouth organ, and... And the singer came on. I remember that. The singer came on.
I think you should sing more on your show. I really do.
Well, I think we don't sing in the two Ronnies, but of course I sing on the stage. I mean, you know, and I make records, as people know. As a matter of fact, my records are very, very popular in Yugoslavia. Where they happen to fit the parking meters. And
well, there you see. I think with a bit of rock, it could be very big.
If I stood on it, you mean?
I think you just need a good rock beat behind you and a safety pin through your left nostril.
Oh, yes.
And you'd be very hip.
Hip.
Very hip.
Hip. Now, what, tell me, what is hip?
Well, he's hip. He'll go far. Pretty soon be a number one star. Dig the glasses he's got on.
Dig the big shoes, how can he lose? Eat your heart out, Elton John. He's so hip.
He's sharp as two tacks. When he swings, ain't a thing that he lacks.
He's as rich as creosote. When he can't speak, can't even squeak. Sidney Nolan paints his throat, he's so hip.
I dig all the rock stars, and I think Molly Meldrum's a grand name.
He digs drinking in bars, and the fags that he smoke have no brand name.
Well, she's hip, she's no square. By the way, have you noticed her hair? Though right now it's powder blue, also it's been purple and green.
She's technicolor dandruff too, she's so hip.
I'm hip, up to date, like I just formed a group and it's great. We're punk rock, which really means
you say stuff you all the way through.
Iron crosses on our jeans,
we're so hip.
We're too much.
You're as cool as a polar bear's crunch.
We're the meanest in the land.
Sink with a snarl, boring Kamal.
We bridge the little river band.
We're so hip. Now look at them, they look just like the Sex Pistols, don't they?
Well, so they should, that's who they model themselves on.
Is that so?
Yeah. And I guarantee that as big they will be with the birds soon.
Their vocabulary is expanding to five-letter words.
Well, he's hip.
I can see. He's as trendy can be.
He makes everybody stare. Folks are impressed. He's so well-dressed.
And that is just his underwear. Let her rip.
It's so hip
to be hip.
Hey, he's so hip. Yeah, so hip to be
hip. Ladies and gentlemen, Brenda Christian. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Last year, thank you very much. Last year, about September time, I think it was. I remember it was September because there was an awful lot of flu about, and even the mice had it. And we used to bait the traps with butter menthols. And a group of us from my club had a night out. Now, by the way, it's not the squash club I'm talking about because. I'm a member of this very, very nice squash club. And, we meet every Friday. Buy a bottle of squash. And this is another club I'm a member of. It's called Height Watchers Anonymous. And we meet, you know, once every other week. The children clear out the doll's house. And I attend regularly, to be honest, because I'm sick of people making rather tasteless jokes, you know, about my height, like, he's so small, he's the last person to know when it starts raining, and that. And the worst one is, does Mickey Mouse wear a Ronnie Corbett wristwatch? So you can see, I am not in any fit state for the second helping of this pop group, but here goes. Anyway, would you welcome, from America, the Grotestics.
now my pleasure to introduce to you my next guests, a very funny pair of gentlemen. As a matter of fact, one half of the act I have something in common with. We share the same tailor, the London Baby Carriage Company. Ladies and gentlemen, Chris Kirby and Terry.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Ronnie, very much. And look, I'm really terribly embarrassed about this afternoon in the dressing room. I do apologise.
What did you do? What did you do?
Well, I went in the dressing room. It was dark. He was in there. I thought it was you. I picked him up and shoved my hand up his back.
I heard he likes that kind of thing.
He said thank you. I don't know. It's really embarrassing when you do stuff like that.
Who are you talking to?
What?
Who are you talking to?
The audience.
Audience?
Yeah.
Who are you on?
Yeah, this is it. I thought it was another rehearsal.
No.
Pick me up.
What?
Pick me up. Pick you up?
Yeah.
What's a cute little thing like you doing?
Off the bloody stool.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How are you?
All right. Me leg hurts, though, but I think I'm all right.
Yeah, that's good. Well, they don't know what you're laughing at home.
Me leg fell off. Don't worry.
Don't explain. Just forget it. Why are you wearing those clothes?
What?
Why are you wearing those clothes?
I'm totally naked under them. It'd look silly if I...
No, I'm wearing a tuxedo. What did I say to you at 3 o'clock this afternoon in the hotel room?
What?
At 3 o'clock in the hotel room. What did I say?
At 3 o'clock. You said, get that girl back on the phone so she'll get off here for $30.
It was 4 o'clock. Now stop it. Oh, I said, wear a tuxedo. It's too late now anyway.
Well, I can't remember everything. I'm tired.
Why are you tired?
I was out late last night.
Were you?
With him.
Him who?
Ronnie.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, he's my friend. We go out together.
Yeah?
Oh, yes, he likes going out with me. I make him feel tall, you see. This is his suit, actually.
Is it?
He's a nice lad.
Yeah, what do?
We go out and we get girls.
Or a girl.
A girl? Just one for the two of us, because you see... No, you see, because we're short, it's hard for us.
Yeah.
So we got a system.
Yeah.
I sit on his shoulders.
Yeah.
And we've put this long raincoat on. And then it looks like I'm 6'3", you see? It's a little easier that way, but we can only get one girl at a time.
Go on, what did you do when you sat on his shoulders and put the raincoat on?
We went to this bar last night, you see, and we're sitting there having a drink. And I'm just sitting there, sipping on a pint of Drandui.
Yeah.
And it's my drink. And I'm passing one under the raincoat every now and again for Ronnie.
Yeah.
And I suddenly looked up and I caught this lady's eye.
Yeah.
And I thought, I'll take it back to her. So I nudged Ronnie.
Yeah.
And I said, come on, Ron, I got one.
Yeah.
I said, let's sidle around the bar.
Yeah.
So we sidled around the bar.
Yeah.
Sidle.
Yeah.
Very furtively.
Yeah.
Because we're full of furt.
Yeah.
And I walked up to the bird and I said, hello, bird. How you doing?
Yeah.
Because I'm very suave.
Yeah.
And she said, all right. And I said, can I take you home? And she said, yes.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes. He got all excited down there.
Yeah.
Oh. Took his jacket off and everything.
Yeah.
So we went outside,
yeah.
Got in the car.
Yeah.
She had a car,
mm-hmm.
And she said, you drive. So he worked the pedals and I steered.
Yeah.
And we got out the front of her place,
yeah,
and turned the engine off,
yeah.
And I put my arms around her,
yeah,
and I got very close,
yeah.
And I started to make sexy noises in her ear,
yeah.
Like a... Not bad, is it?
It's not good.
So I did that, and then I started to chew on her ear.
Did you?
Because they like that, having their ear chewed.
Yeah.
So I chewed for about half an hour.
Yeah.
Her ear was soaking wet. And I thought, this is it.
Yeah.
This is it, I thought. So I leaned over and I said in her ear, I said, excuse me, my dear, why don't we go inside?
What did she say?
No.
Quite right.
So I thought to myself, not quite ready yet.
Yeah.
So I said, hang on a sec, Ron, I'll chew for a bit longer. Well, what happened then? Well, we got inside, you see, inside our house, to cut a long story short.
Good.
And so I'm standing there on top of his shoulders in the raincoat.
Yeah.
She said, take your coat off. And I said, no, I'll stand here for a while like this. It's a bit chilly.
Yeah.
And so she said, you're tall, aren't you? And I said, yes. She said, well, I like short fellas.
Yeah.
So I thought, hello, hello, this is good. Get ready to reveal ourselves.
Yeah.
So she said, sit on the couch. So we got onto the couch and she said, excuse me while I go and slip into something comfortable.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And she disappeared. So we took the raincoat off. Ronnie's down to his undies by this time.
Yeah.
And Ronnie and I sat on the couch for 4 hours.
4 hours?
Yeah.
Didn't she slip into something comfortable?
Yeah, she went to bed.
I'm honoured tonight to introduce you to my next guest. Now, she is a truly international Australian star. She has graced the stages of Covent Garden and Sadler's Wells in London and the opera and musical comedy stages of Australia. I've known her for years, and I hope you'll give her a very warm welcome to your own, your very own, June Bronhill. That was absolutely lovely, June.
Oh,
really lovely.
Thank you, Ronnie. But why are you dressed like that?
Well, it just seemed appropriate somehow, you know, because I happen to be a fan of Noel Coward's.
Ivor Novello.
Have you really? I'm awfully sorry.
No, the song. The song was written by Ivor Novello.
Oh, yes, I know that. I mean, when I said Noel Coward, I didn't mean, you know, that Noel Coward. I meant the other one who, you know.
The other one?
Yes, you know, the one who's called Ivor Novello, you know.
I see.
The one who wrote Rosemarie.
That was Frimmel.
Yes, I thought it was too. I didn't like it at all. I thought that was very Frimmel, yes. Now, I much preferred Hansel and Gretel.
Ah, Humperdinck.
Pardon?
Humperdinck.
Well, we'll get you a glass of water, dear.
No. The opera Hansel and Gretel was written by Humperdinck.
June, as it happens, there are two things close to my heart.
Mm-hmm.
One is the ground, of course. The other is opera.
I had no idea that you were an opera lover. Tell me, which school do you favour?
Well, I favoured St. Peregrine's Primary until they started.
Listen. Yes. Did you see me in Götterdämmerung last July?
No, as a matter of fact, I went to Surfers Paradise. We always go there.
Dolly, I thought you said you loved opera.
June, I absolutely adore. I'll have you know, I played washboard for Joan Sutherland. Yes, until it fell on top of me. Now, June, you're going to sing us a little aria now, aren't you?
I certainly am.
That's
yes,
right.
Yes.
Well, why don't you go off and change?
All right.
And I'll slip into my sort of version of Bill Collins.
A shortened version.
That's the one.
See you in a minute.
Ladies and gentlemen, June Braun here. Good evening and welcome to La Scala Burwood, where you join us in time for scene 22, act 9 of that great opera by Lasagna Verdi, Isola Mio Degli Cascari. The loneliness of the long-distance runner. The opera tells the story of Renata, a lovely gypsy girl, daughter of a drunken bearded pistachio. One morning, she meets and marries Commander Plankton of the U.S. Navy in the beautiful duet Ciao Ciao Capitano, or Hello Sailor. Renata remains faithful to Plankton and even more faithful to an entire regiment of Alpine irregulars. As the act begins, we see Alessandra seated in the courtyard, cosily fanning her tutti. She is the half-daughter of her half-father, Semidetaccio, and after a quarrel, she threatens to die of consumption. Semidetaccio, mad with rage and foolishly disguised as Ernie Sigley, attempts to climb over the parapet, but is caught by the carabinieri. In a touching farewell scene, he is hung, drawn, and quartered. His body, now in four pieces, just manages to sing in quadraphonic sound. The wonderful aria, Ouch, Nupi Nalgo Natsopa. Unfortunately, little Patty has a cold tonight, so the part of Flight Lieutenant Milbrace will be sung by the pipes and drums of Maine Nicholas. We join the action now as Renata, left to starve to death in the Doge's dungeons, is secretly fed by her past lovers and is soon imprisoned in the Leaning Tower of Pizza. Totally without legal aid, she awaits the arrival of almost anybody.
Awaiting my fate from this perilous danger, my deliverer, liberate and free me. Oh! Will you save me, handsome stranger, all alone, awaiting my fate? Ha ha ha!
shall escape 'neath the cape of thy gloom.
To be loved.
Only I'll hold thee. Come, let us fly together. Dearest, these arms enfold thee, soft as a feather, my little dove.
My hero, my hero.
Sorry, I'm trying to recall one of the tunes I used to play in the early days when I played the piano in a nightclub, you know. I used to play. Manager used to give me 30 bob, you know, to sit at the piano for a couple of hours. Customers would give me 2 quid to sit somewhere else. don't get the wrong idea. I mean, it wasn't a very posh nightclub, you know. It was, as a matter of fact, it used to be a public convenience. a lot of people came in there not realizing it had changed hands. Things we saw coming in the front door. You can put that away for a start, people. I was, for a change, I'd like to devote the rest of my little spot to playing you a medley of my favourite tunes, you know. And if there's anybody in the studio audience feels like joining in, please don't, because it's tricky enough without a lot of interference. So here we are then. I'll start off with Come Into the Garden, Maud. That was damn clever. How do I do that? Oh, sorry. Excuse me. Sorry about that. Hello? Yes? Yes, there is a lot more of it. Yeah. Well, what about Land of Hope and Glory? Would you like that? Or Up There, Casale? Would you like that? Stop Your Tickling Jock? Or Handel's Lago? Lago. Not the way I play it. All right, then. All right. If you say so. Yes, all right. Yes, okay. So much jealousy in this place, you know. I'm sorry about that. I am now not going to play you a medley of my favourite tunes, which is rather a pity because a lot of viewers have written in to me. Sorry, I must stop saying that. A lot of viewers, you know, a lot of viewers haven't written in, you know. No, I'll be honest, nobody ever writes to me. No, a Paul Scoopin is a fan letter to me, to be honest. I get so little mail, my letterbox is healed up. By the way, I must say, taking the economic situation into account, I'd just like to say how much I appreciate all that Channel 9 has laid on for me, you know, just to make me feel, you know, well, important, like a star, really, I suppose. I mean, there's the wine there. Look at this wine. Real Havana cigars. Look at that. Isn't that lovely? Just absolutely lovely. It's, Hello? Oh, yes, sir. Sorry. Yes. Right. Yes, certainly. Mm. Silly. Sorry? Oh, sorry. Yes, I didn't. Sorry. Yes, I didn't realize. and the lovely wine. Look at this beautiful wine. I must show you that. Isn't that... excuse me. Yes. Rare vintage port, it's called. Very nice. A bit rarer than I thought. Just as well, really, because I'm not really a great drinker. You know, a couple of pints of beer, the second one goes straight to my head. Let's face it, the very other few other places I can get to. But I learned my lesson after the show last week, to be honest. I had a few drinks, and I left them back to the dressing room and a few more drinks, you know, chat-chat, sip in the dressing room. I left the studio. I was round and round about the wrong way, turned into Regent Street, hit the back of a bus, and finished up in a shop doorway on the other side of the road. I remember thinking to myself, thank God I'm not in the car. back to the pier. Sometimes I wish I were more like my dad, you know. I mean, he could not only play the Blue Danube, but he could drink it. He was actually the founder member, my dad, of the Duke of Clarence Homeward Bound Scheme. You know, if at closing time in the Duke of Clarence you couldn't walk, they put you in a taxi. Quite a good idea, really. Which, incidentally, reminds me of a very funny story about a chap who goes into a bottle shop, you see, and he says to the fellow behind the counter, he said, I'd like a bottle of Scotch whiskey. To which the man replied, he said, I'm very sorry, sir. He said, we're right out of Scotch whiskey. What about a nice bottle of Irish whiskey? And the chap said, well, I'm sorry, I've never tried Irish whiskey. So the man said, well, sir, make up your mind or I'll smash your face in. No, he didn't. No, he didn't actually say that. I put that in to see if you're still listening. And, see if you're still here. And, he said, it's a very, very nice whiskey, he said. As a matter of fact, he said, it is blended with Old Pete. Chap said, that's very interesting, because I often wonder what happened to Old Pete. He said, no, he didn't. No, he didn't say that either. I put that in to see if you're still listening. And you weren't. He didn't. He just simply bought this bottle of Irish whiskey, you see, and off he went. Next day, he came back to the bottle shop and he said, that Irish whiskey, you know, that you sold me was fantastic. He said, my wife finished and I finished the whole bottle. What a night, he said. Scenes of unparalleled passion. I mean, he said, second honeymoon. He said, and you're not going to believe this. He said, this morning we got up very early and we went to mass. He said, how about that? We went to mass. The man said, well, what's so unusual about that? He said, well, we're Jewish. Thank you. Thank you very much. That's all for this week. I'd like to thank you for watching and my guests for coming. See you next week. Night-night.